Thank you very much, John. It's a great pleasure to be here back at Cambridge. It's been a long time since I was here, many years ago, visiting my former professor of obligations, Tony Weir, who was at Trinity College for many years. Great pleasure to reconnect with friends from various Commonwealth jurisdictions that I've seen over the years. I'm sure all of you have studiously read every word of my paper, particularly those of you who have had long plane flights, and I'll therefore try simply to summarize, remind you of some of the points, and then perhaps we can have some discussion in the time that remains. The paper really proceeds in three sections. I make three points that attempt to connect up some broad philosophical ideas with some more grubby legal implementation ideas, beginning with the idea of public reason, which, as many of you will know, since perhaps the late 1960s, has been virtually the only game in town in political philosophy, attempting heroically to connect up the ideas of personal and individual liberty, governmental coercion, and value pluralism, the idea being to attempt to justify within the bounds of individual liberty, state coercion, given an extreme recognition of value pluralism. My suggestion in the paper is that this set of ideas, while necessary and heroic, has certain difficulties, particularly difficulties of scope, that value pluralism is a bit more unrelenting than the public reason theorists might wish, and therefore every public reason theory has to be qualified in some way, and sometimes qualified procedurally. That is, it would work to legitimate state coercion to explain the reasons for it, provided that those persons to whom explanation was made reasoned rather like I do, or within some general set of substantive liberal democratic values. The other move is to say, well, I don't want to substantively limit the scope of the theory. Perhaps it needs to be procedurally limited. I think that even given value pluralism, those who heard the reasons would, if they reasoned long enough and hard enough, come to see that the state coercion was, in this instance, justified, or, of course, in some circumstances, not justified. So people within these theories have to be treated as if they were, in some sense, hypothetical persons, persons having some set of substantive ideas in common, or persons who had the capacity over long procedures to come to view things rather in the same way. In some sense, this falsifies one of the basic premises of the whole enterprise, which is we will conquer value pluralism. Value pluralism gets conquered by sweeping it under the rug in some sense. But then, what are we to do with respect to the legitimation of modern administrative states? We can hardly rely on consent. Consent is extremely abstract in most modern large administrative states. We consent reluctantly to elect the people put up in our various constituencies. They then go off to representative assemblies. I use representative in scare quotes, where they then delegate much of policymaking to a set of administrators who are themselves not elected and are within some broad bounds within the political control of those representatives. But the broad bounds are extremely broad indeed. Most legislation is not self-interpreting. Indeed, none of it is. And as a consequence, it is the administrators themselves who make a great deal of the policy to which citizens are subjected. consent simply won't do it. Perhaps there are still jurisdictions within which administrators are viewed as sufficiently expert and professional that they have direct access to the truth of the matter. But by and large, we tend not to think so. Because we do recognize value pluralism, to think that these administrators have values which they insert into the process of policymaking. They're not mere automatons who implement the direct will of the legislature. And as a consequence, we need some way to justify that what they do is legitimate. And it seems to me that in most jurisdictions, what we have come to is something like what the political philosophers have suggested. That is, they must give reasons. And the reasons are the justification for the actions. And to some degree, my suggestion is that this approach, this requirement of reason giving for legitimacy, is a success. That is, although there are difficulties at a philosophical level with the public reason project, and certainly practical difficulties with reason giving in administrative jurisdictions. Nevertheless, we no longer believe that anybody has direct access to truth. We no longer believe that consent has actually been given to the coercive activities of administrators. And therefore, in some sense, they must convince us, if we are to be subject to the law and not mere objects of it, that they have done something for reasons which we can understand to be a justification for collective action. Now, it may well be that in the United States we have taken this further than almost any other jurisdiction. In some situations, we seem to take it to almost laughable lengths. Our courts, for example, in reviewing administrative action, have required administrators not just to give reasons, but to give reasons at the time that they make the decision. No post hoc rationalizations allowed. I suppose this is a great ambition, although I know no one in the psychology fraternity who believes that any reasons are anything other than post hoc rationalizations. Nevertheless, you can't do it simply as litigation affidavits and the like. You've got to provide your reasons at the time that you make the decision. The reasons have to be responsive to the record, that is, to the submissions of parties. And in the U.S., this is both in the adjudicatory context and in the rulemaking context. And these requirements can be extremely demanding. They are mostly put forward as procedural requirements. That is, although the Administrative Procedure Act says that judges are to reverse decisions which are arbitrary or capricious or lacking in substantial evidence, what the judge generally asks is whether the administrator has given good enough reasons for the activity. And even if the judge would believe that the administrator has acted properly, if the reasons are improper, there is nevertheless an invalidation, a remand to go back and think again. And thinking again may merely be thinking about what reasons the judge would accept if we gave them differently. In some ways, this becomes a sort of checklist. Has the administrator demonstrated thought about all the considerations which seem to be relevant to the determination? Has the administrator excluded from consideration all those things which are excluded from consideration? At some level, it becomes substantive, that is, pure arbitrariness, unreasonableness. But one rarely finds a judicial opinion saying simply the administrator has, not to put too fine a point of it, been too stupid to be believed. We're going to overturn because they're simply wrong. Mostly, the suggestion is that a procedural mistake has been made, failure to respond to adequately raised objections and the like. This, of course, is at one level designed to protect the judiciary from engaging in activities which, under our and most jurisdictions' vision of separation of powers, judges are not meant to engage in, that is, policy choice on their own. The legislature or the parliament has given policy choice to the administrator, not to the judges, by and large. The judges then are to see that the administrator stays within those bounds and looks primarily, at least in the U.S., to the reasoning process to see whether those bounds have been maintained. Now, I say in the paper that in some ways I think this has been a triumph. After all, you know, this is carrying forward, in some sense, the whole of the Enlightenment project of substituting reason or myth, culture, faith, none of those things in pluralistic societies any longer will legitimate administrative or governmental action for us, by and large. And as a consequence, it is a success, in some sense. Indeed, those who celebrate its success have seen it in many ways as instantiating a form of deliberative democracy in which citizens participate in a more thoroughgoing way at the administrative level than they do in politics, in which they merely aggregate their votes, and the U.S. aggregate their dollars, to elect various parties, and then shudder at what they do in the parliament or the legislature. They can have direct access and are guaranteed direct access to the decision makers who must then respond. Now, as I say in the paper, there is a downside to this as well. One downside is that reason giving can become a sort of end in itself. And one might think that in the U.S. perhaps it has, because it's not just the judiciary that imposes reason giving requirements on American administrators. We have a whole series of other analytic requirements imposed both by statute and by the executive order, by executive orders, which require that administrators, when making decisions, consider environmental impacts, regulatory impacts in terms of cost-benefit analysis, regulatory impacts in terms of cost-effectiveness, regulatory impacts in terms of effects on small entities, special consideration for regulatory impacts on Native Americans, special consideration of paperwork burdens imposed by regulatory activity, and so on. Most of those requirements are not enforced by the courts. Some of them are not enforced by anybody, but others are enforced in the Executive Office of the President, the Office of Management and Budget, and a special bureau called the Office of Information and Regulatory Affairs, in which has to review at least the regulatory impact analyses and the paperwork burden analyses for all major regulations by federal administrative agencies. Certain other requirements, the Regulatory Flexibility Act requirements with respect to small entities, simply are overseen by political controllers, and not very effectively, I might add. If you look at the organization of American regulatory agencies, take a large one, the Environmental Protection Agency, which has thousands of employees, you will find that there are special bureaus set up within the agency to deal with all of these analytic requirements. Every one of them has its staff, and some of these staffs are quite large, to make sure that the agency has thought about all of the things that statute and regulation and executive order requires be thought about. And thinking about it takes time. The regulatory process in the United States is often described as ossified. That terminology simply comes from a speech years ago by the then general counsel of the Environmental Protection Agency, who coined the term of ossification. And there's a huge literature, actually, a cottage industry, almost an industry, not a cottage, devoted to the ossification question. Does it exist? To what extent does it exist? What are its causes? And so on. So that paralysis by analysis can infect administration because of a legitimate desire to require that agencies not only give us reasons why they are acting appropriately given their organic statutes, their basic missions, but also that they have understood that their basic mission does not exhaust our desires for a good life, that we can care about the environment, we care about cost, we care about imposing undue burdens on people who have difficulty bearing them, and so on. It's a side effect, and perhaps one that is exploited by another difficulty in the reason-giving approach to legitimacy, and that is that requirements of responsiveness can mean that those who are extremely well-resourced are able to use reason-giving as a form of harassment rather than a form of legitimation. And indeed, regulatory disbeneficiaries, that is, those who must comply with regulations rather than being the beneficiaries of their compliance, often raise very large numbers of objections to proposals by administrators. And if one looks empirically at the submissions, for example, in American regulatory rulemaking proceedings, you find that 85 to 90% of those submissions are from regulated parties and not from the general public or from the potential beneficiaries. Having looked with some care years ago at regulation of automobile safety in the United States, I found that simply one firm, the Ford Motor Company, had more employees devoted to auto safety regulation than the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration had devoted to those same regulations. They're completely overmatched and nevertheless must be responsive to the well-reasoned, and if you're well-resourced, they will be well-reasoned objections of parties. So that this image of deliberative democracy is an image that in practice often speaks with the voice of the regulated rather than with the voice of the public generally. Pluralism has its costs if you don't regulate participation in some way, which of course in itself would be a weakness of the participatory model. But I wanted to suggest in my paper that there may be a deeper problem with reason giving in the administrative state. That is, it has these practical difficulties, limitations on the ability of government to act, perhaps allowing what some people call a form of epistemic capture with respect to regulators because of the resources of those who object to their activities. But I think there's something further at work here, and what I'm suggesting in the paper is that the reasons that we give for administrative action are reasons which sound essentially in instrumental rationality. Given the goal of this statute and the facts as we have found it, if you want to meet that goal, then for some set of highly technocratic reasons, quite often, this policy makes sense. And that responds to a form of scientific or technocratic rationality, but bowdlerizing some of Habermas's thought, my paper suggests that there are other realms of rationality within which we all operate, not just the material world, but the social and the personal as well. And in the social world, we're concerned about justice and morality. In the personal world, we're concerned about authenticity. And administrative reason giving, however sophisticated it has become, doesn't speak to those forms of rationality. It doesn't speak in ways that are truly legitimating with respect to situations in which there may be a perfectly good material or technocratic reason, and nevertheless we're disappointed by the outcome and have a failure of understanding, both generally and perhaps even among elites, as to what's going on and whether it is in fact appropriate. cost-benefit analysis is, to some degree, an important development. I think in virtually all of our jurisdictions, there's now regulatory analysis that looks at costs and benefits. Certainly makes sense. Regulators don't have an explicit budget other than for staff and personnel and equipment. They don't have a regulatory budget. They therefore might willy-nilly impose all manner of unwanted costs on society. And yet underneath that analysis are a whole series of extraordinary, indeed excruciating questions about the values that are plugged into those analyses. And there are professional norms about the way in which these things are done in the economics fraternity. But those professional norms are largely designed to allow one to get on with the job of doing the cost-benefit analysis, not necessarily speaking to the difficult moral and political questions that underlie it. Let me close by suggesting one example. I actually know of only one example in the United States in which an administrator has attempted to broaden the question of what reasons are good enough with respect to a regulation. And that was Secretary of Transportation Coleman, way back in the Ford administration, who was faced with a question having to do, again, with automobile safety. And Secretary Coleman, in one of the 24 notices of proposed rulemaking that stretched over 20 years in adopting a particular rule, said, you know, my statute says that we're supposed to regulate unreasonable risks of harm. How should I think about unreasonable? Because one of the things that this rule had to do with the imposition of requirements of passive restraints in automobiles. The automobiles at that time all were by regulation required to have lap and shoulder belts, but this was the so-called airbags rule. And airbags were much more expensive than the lap and shoulder belts, and the lap and shoulder belts were already there. And Professor Coleman, Secretary Coleman, sometimes teaches, said, you know, we're supposed to regulate unreasonable risk. Now, we've gone out and tried to find the extent to which people, in fact, use those lap and shoulder belts. And we've done it in two ways. One, we took a poll, and 65 to 70% of Americans said they wore their lap and shoulder belt. And then we sent some people out with binoculars to stand on overpasses and look at drivers and passengers in automobiles. And what we find is 14% of Americans actually wear their lap and shoulder belt. Now, are they being unreasonable? That is, they've got those lap and shoulder belts there in the car. They don't put them on. If a vast majority of Americans don't wear them, are they running an unreasonable risk of harm? That is, how are we to think about reasonable? Should we think about it in what the ordinary reasonable American does? If so, this is not an unreasonable risk. Moreover, said Secretary Coleman, those belts are already in the automobiles. And the people who think the risk is unreasonable to them wear them. Those who don't, don't. If we adopt this rule, we're going to make automobiles more expensive, and we'll require those people who already protect themselves and are as protected as they will be. Actually, the lap and shoulder belts are a little bit better than the airbags, I'm sad to say. At protecting drivers and passengers. We're going to impose costs on them which are in some sense unfair, that is. They've already got the equipment and they use it. And we're protecting people who don't want to be protected at a cost to people who are already protected. Is this reasonable? Good questions about the justice of this rule. In the submissions that came back, there was deafening silence. The people who participate in these proceedings simply didn't know how to deal with the broadening of the question that Secretary Goldman was attempting to bring up. He learned virtually nothing. Now, the questions he asked were so difficult that it might have been he would have learned virtually nothing if people had responded in great numbers. But it's a difficult it's a difficult matter. And alas, in my paper ends something on a downer. That is, it seems to me that there are extremely difficult problems in building in to what we now treat as administrative rationality, some broadening out into rational discussions which would satisfy our hunger for things that speak both to our sense of justice and morality and to our sense of ourselves as authentic individuals. But nevertheless, it seems to me that in modern administrative states, if we are to continue to govern in the way that we now govern, which is largely, it seems to me, by administrators, design of public institutions need to, in some way, attempt to take these matters into account if it intends to remain in any broad sense legitimate to the public that it necessarily coerces. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Jerry. That was a very thought-provoking and challenging set of questions for us. And we have a little over 10 minutes for questions. If you could introduce yourselves. There are two people with microphones right here. If you could raise your hand if you would like to make an intervention, and then I will bring in people. So, one here, please.
Thank you. I'm David Eisenhaus, University of Toronto. So, I was interested in the way that your paper moved registers, as it were. So, the way I understood it and your presentation is that you start off by telling us that the public reason stuff in political philosophy is too heroic. And then we have a move to something that looks actually quite unheroic, and that's reason giving in the administrative state. But then the complaint at the end is that reason giving in the administrative state isn't heroic enough. And when it tries to become heroic, we end up with something like the same kinds of problems that we encounter in political philosophy. And that is, we find that if we're going to broaden things out with the practices of reason giving, we start operating with a hypothetical subject rather than the actual people that these directives are directed against. So I wondered if you could say something about this kind of heroic, unheroic tension, if you like, in the paper.
Right, thank you, David. I was living in fear of David raising his hand. He's much deeper into the philosophic literature than I am. Well, I guess my idea is this, that at the unheroic level, the conversation doesn't have to be amongst philosophers, right? So that the fact that there is a slippage, that is, that we deliberate about these matters and don't actually agree, and to some extent fail to accept all of us the reasons that are given, doesn't necessarily undermine the value of having the conversation about them. That is, it may be that as a practical matter, we can accept ultimately decisions about which we deeply disagree substantively, but come to understand that this is not a mere imposition of the will of others on us, but instead represents strongly held, or perhaps only provisionally held, beliefs and ideas, which nevertheless they're prepared to defend openly, and therefore recognize in some democratic spirit that we're all entitled to understand where they're coming from, and that they're coming from places that respond to a whole set of values that we all tend to hold, although disagree about their valence or applicability in particular circumstances. So, as I say at one point in the paper, I'm suggesting that public reason is one of those things which doesn't seem to work very well in theory, but might work out okay in practice, simply because our demands are less demanding than those of the political philosophy.
Thank you. Aileen Kavanagh, University of Oxford. Thanks for a fascinating paper. It is an issue that we're thinking about a lot now in UK administrative law and in constitutional law. I have two brief questions. And the first is one of information. I was wondering if there is any empirical work in the United States on whether these reasoning requirements set by courts are being genuinely internalized by agencies, or whether it's having no effect or it's producing a tick box mentality and is actually just a false charade of good reasoning that would fly in the courts rather than a genuinely internalizing a good way of reasoning, if it is good, and other questions about the cost of doing so, even if it is good. So that's the first question. And the second is the point you made about these reasoning requirements being partly justified by legitimizing the courts in a non-interventionist stance. And I wasn't too sure whether you were presenting that as a view that's often put forward or whether you owned it. And I was wondering about your view on that, because it seemed to me that if the courts are telling agencies how to reason, that has a systemic effect, is potentially highly intrusive. It's telling them essentially what is or is not appropriate action. And that's not only highly intrusive, but potentially more intrusive than an isolated strike down of one decision of substance. So I wondered what your view was on that too. Thank you.
Right. On the first one, there is indeed some empirical literature on whether this is internalized by agencies, or whether they, in some sense, hive off various questions into bureaus which go their own way, do the analyses, and it doesn't have any effect on decision making. And in fact, as one might expect, what you find is the answer is yes and no, right? That in some agencies there seems to be a substantial effect, so that, for example, the Corps of Engineers, which does lots of public infrastructure projects in the United States, was for many years an organization. It comes essentially out of the old Army Corps of Engineers, dating back to the beginning of the Republic. Their vision of America seemed to be that it should have concrete everywhere, that every stream should be straightened, made into a culvert, and the like. Then came the Environmental Protection Act, requiring environmental impact statements, and studies of Corps of Engineers suggest that, in fact, the mentality and culture of that organization has radically shifted over time. It wasn't instantaneous, obviously. But different people began to be attracted to the Corps, and it was almost fully internalized in some way there. That has not happened in other agencies, and particularly with respect to cost-benefit analyses in agencies where the questions tend not to lend themselves very well to that sort of analysis. They're trying to do something which will keep the Office of Management and Budget from bludgeoning them in one way or another, but only that. It's simply done to satisfy the bureaucratic controllers and so on. So you're going to find different things in different agencies. Now, with respect to the whether judicial review for the reasoning process, in fact, keeps judges in their place. I don't actually own that very deeply. That is, I see quite a few instances in which it seems perfectly clear that the judges are interested in the reasoning process only because they view the outcome as in some sense misplaced, unwarranted, and the like. I think that in other Commonwealth jurisdictions, the judges have been perhaps a little more restrained, have kept themselves more within what might be viewed as a standard judicial role. American judges have particularly been invited into this by Congress doing something which I think probably was a mistake in a large number of regulatory statutes, and that is to allow judicial review immediately upon the enactment or adoption of a rule, rather than at some stage in which it's being implemented, and you have some practical understanding of how the thing works in, on the ground. So that in some sense this review is trying to imagine whether in practice this would be a reasonable regulation to impose on various parties. And that the world is a more complex place than we can imagine. And things that look like they're going to be difficult often may turn out to be quite easy. Give one limited example, again, from the auto safety situation. There was a regulation which required labeling of certain characteristics of tires on retreaded tires in order that people would understand what their limits were. It was attacked as being unreasonable and overturned on the grounds that the agency had not appropriately responded to a suggestion by tire retreaders that it was going to be very expensive and perhaps not very useful. Between the time that the agency adopted the regulation and the case was heard on appeal, innovative people at the 3M Corporation came up with an adhesive sticker that had these characteristics of the automobile, of the tire on them, which could be affixed to the tire permanently for 12 cents rather than the $3.50 or whatever it was to vulcanize it into the casings. This was completely irrelevant on review because this was not something that the agency knew at the time that it adopted its regulation, and therefore its reasoning was inadequate, even though it turns out that it would have been quite reasonable. Now, if review had been delayed until someone had this enforced against them, this knowledge would have been available and perhaps justificatory. So I think judges have sometimes appeared to overstep the bounds of appropriate judicial action because they've been invited to do something which is extremely difficult to do in the abstract.
Thank you. Carol Harlow, London School of Economics. I know that although you've talked a lot about, in this particular piece, about the United States, that you're well familiar with Europe, and European administrative law could be seen as a system that's built around reason giving. Now, pondering on that and pondering on the article you yourself wrote about it, it seems to me that the outcome has been a particularly bureaucratic form of administration in which the reason giving requirement has produced a sort of hollow shell around substantive decisions which are never really spoken of. And I wonder whether you would comment on that. And I have a second and not very linked question, which is, it seems also to me that in the United Kingdom, the idea of fairness has become the central concept of administrative law. And you mentioned fairness in your presentation, and I wonder how you see those two ideas as clipped in, reason giving and fairness.
Okay. Let me take the second one first. To some extent, they're linked in the United States by the suggestion that it would be unfair not to give reasons, right? Because people need to know whether it's sensible to try to carry this dispute further, so that the reason giving is in some sense parasitic on an idea of fairness. I think there's another sense in which fairness can be judged in terms of whether the process is one which is likely to lead to an appropriate result, that is, accurate findings of fact, appropriate appreciation of policy and their application to fact, so that to be substantively reasonable is, in some sense, also to provide a fair process within which one can reason. So I think they're very closely related in both of those ways. I'll not say much about the European context, which I knew pretty well 50 years ago when I did my PhD thesis on the Court of Justice of the European Communities, but don't know nearly so well now. But as you suggest, I think it may be exemplary of the problem I was raising just at the end of the lecture. That is, the sense that looking at these reasons, they're not speaking to us. They're failing in some important way to respond to the sorts of concerns that we have, and therefore are simultaneously legally legitimating because they've done the checklist, and substantively not legitimating because they haven't spoken to the substance that we care about.
I'm afraid, because of time, we'll and make sure that the groups take place reasonably on time. We'll have to limit the discussion there. Can I thank Jerry very much for his contribution, because it has introduced the issue of the relationship between procedure and substance very clearly and very engagingly. And I hope that will set the tone for the rest of the conversations that will happen through today and tomorrow.